Stay at home, Shakespeare!
Hello everyone, I'm Emma Whipday, and this is Stay at Home, Shakespeare for A Bit Lit. As those of you who've been watching this series may know, Stay at Home, Shakespeare is both an exploration of ideas about Shakespeare from me in my home in lockdown, perhaps to you in yours, but also an exploration of what the home means in Shakespeare, and how anxieties about the home circulated in early modern England. So far in this series, I've mostly been focusing on Shakespeare's tragedies and how the home can become a tragic space. But today I want to think about something a bit different. In this final video of the series, I'm thinking about A Midsummer Night's Dream and how, in this classic Shakespearean comedy, the unsettling and potentially dangerous influence of the fairies finds itself inside the palace and potentially undermines the happy ending at the end of the play. But in order to explore that, I need to start by thinking about what it means to be a fairy in A Midsummer Night's Dream. And so I want to take a little bit of time to think about Act 1, Scene 2, when a fairy meets Puck and talks about what a fairy gets up to in this play. The fairy says, "Over hill, over dale, thorough bush or through bush, thorough briar, over park, over pale, thorough flood, thorough fire, I do wander everywhere, swifter than the moon's sphere, and I serve the fairy queen to dew her orbs upon the green." Now this fairy is nameless and simply referred to as fairy, and I think therefore we can think about this fairy as representative of what a fairy is in the play. It's a generalised fairy. And the fairy seems mostly to travel over hill and dale, through bush and briar, over park and pale, through flood and through fire. So it seems to be travelling far, far enough that the fairy no longer thinks in particular terms, this particular hill or dale, but just in terms of general features of the landscape. And it also seems to be travelling through elements, over earth, through water, and through fire. We know that the fairy serves the fairy queen, so exists in some kind of hierarchy. And if you've been watching previous videos in this series, you'll know that in early modern England, hierarchy was associated with order, with goodness, with safety. And we also know that this fairy is involved in the natural world, that one of the fairy's tasks is to dew her orbs upon the green, a really lovely phrase that seems to refer to the nighttime dew. The fairy is leaving dew upon the grass in the fairy queen's world. However, while this is a beautiful image, there's also something slightly unsettling about this fairy in early modern terms, because the main thing the fairy does is move, and more specifically, fly. In my video last week on King Lear, I explored how movement in this period, and particularly the transgressive movement of beggars, could be associated with violence and with danger. Virtuous good people stayed in their homes, stayed in one place, and it's those who move between spaces and are open to the elements that were often perceived as a threat. This fairy both moves and flies, which is something that, in this period, is very much associated with witchcraft. So a question arises as to whether the fairy is a good, benign creature that performs only good magic, or whether, in the early modern worldview, it's potentially, like witches, associated with danger and the demonic. And I've discovered a pamphlet that might help to shed a little bit of light on this. It's a witchcraft pamphlet called A Most Wicked Work of a Wretched Witch, and it tells about the misbehaviour of a witch that eventually led to her execution. Or, I should say, the misbehaviour of a woman accused of witchcraft, because of course the real woman is unlikely to have been a witch, and yet nonetheless died for it. In this pamphlet, which was published in 1592, so just a couple of years before Midsummer Night's Dream was written, a witch enchants a farm worker called Richard Burt because he tells her in public that she is a witch. But the way she enchants him is a little bit unusual and not at all like the kinds of enchantments we might expect. Indeed, not like an enchantment I found in any other witch pamphlet. Essentially, when he's working in his master's barn and he decides to take a break and eat his packed lunch, including a slice of apple pie, she causes a cat that's in the straw nearby to start churning up the straw and distracting him from his lunch. He then hears a magical voice telling him to come outside the barn. Come away, the voice calls. And at this point, holding his apple pie, he goes outside. And the pamphlet says, poor simplicity, for he's not considered to be a very intelligent farm worker, poor simplicity, keeping his apple pie still in his hand, came to the barn door when suddenly he was hoisted up into the air and carried over many fields, by the way espying his master's plough a-ploughing, but not able to call unto them, although he seemed to have a memory most perfect, so he knows what's going on and remembers things, but can't speak. Thence passing over to Harrow, where on the side of the hill there is a great pond, was drawn through, was violently wrapped up the hill, and over the tops of the trees at Harrow Church, being hauled further, he was taken, as he seemeth, into a place which was all fire. So having been dragged through the landscape and made to magically fly, he finds himself in some sort of hellish dimension. I find it striking how much this account resonates with what's going on with the fairy in A Midsummer Night's Dream. The fairy says that he or she is travelling over hill, over dale, through bush, through briar, through flood, through fire, through all these different elements and across this landscape. It's more generalised than Richard Burt's description, so we get the generalised hill and dale rather than passing over to Harrow. On the side of the hill there is a great pond over the tops of the trees at Harrow Church. So Richard Burt's knowledge is local knowledge, it's human particular knowledge, while the fairy's supernatural knowledge seems a lot more general. But once Richard Burt finds himself in the hellish place, he's then magically dragged back home again after he refuses to serve the people who, or the demons who live in the hellish place. And then his journey is described as soaring over hedges and ditches, soused in mire and dirt, scratched with thorns and briar. So again, this sounds an awful lot like being dragged through bush, through briar. Again, he's being pulled through different elements, the watery mire as well as the earth. And here you'll notice his descriptions, like those of the fairy, have become generalised. He no longer knows where he is. He's moving through hedges and through ditches, but he can't name them. So it's possible that when he was writing his fairy's journey, Shakespeare was drawing on a recent account of an enchantment by a witch, that when he was constructing fairy magic, he also had witchcraft in mind. But even if he didn't know of this particular account, he still seems to be drawing on tropes, on motifs, on common ideas associated with witchcraft. We can see this in the way that Puck is described. The fairy says to Puck, "Either I mistake your shape and making quite, or else you are that shrewd and knavish sprite called Robin Goodfellow. Are not you he that frights the maidens of the villagery, skim milk and sometimes labour in the quern, and bootless make the breathless housewife churn?" So essentially the fairy's saying, don't you do things like stop the housewife from being able to make butter so that she's bootless, pointlessly churning the milk, but the cream or butter never comes? So this kind of activity, on the one hand, is associated with a common folkloric figure of Robin Goodfellow, a kind of mischievous fairy sprite creature who's associated with mischief but also with housework, who's a sort of benign, innocent fairy. But stopping milk being churned up is also something that witches do. It's the kind of domestic disruption they're believed to specialise in this period. And Puck responds, "I am that merry wanderer of the night." And wandering, again, is associated not just with fairies, but with the transgressive movements of witches. I wanted to start by discussing these potentially dangerous, witchy, demonic resonances of the fairies' magic, because the forest and the woods in Midsummer Night's Dream are often talked about, like in many other Shakespeare plays, as a green world, a green wood, a place of disruption maybe, of topsy-turvydom, of magic, but essentially a joyous, festive, celebratory place. But I'm not sure that's entirely true of the woods in A Midsummer Night's Dream. They're in many ways a very dark and dangerous world. People lose their sense of their own identity, lose their sense of who they love, become, like Bottom, entrapped there. So potentially, there's this darker, more unsettling magic underneath the green world of the woods and the benign fun and merriness of the fairies. And this makes the ending of the play a little more suspect. When the play is ending and all has been sorted out, the comedy's been tied up, the lovers are married, and everyone's going off to their separate wedding nights, Theseus, the Duke of Athens, says, "The iron tongue of midnight hath told 12. Lovers to bed, 'tis almost fairy time." So essentially he's associating midnight, which is also the witching hour, with fairies. He continues, "I fear we shall outsleep the coming morn, as much as we this night have overwatched." So we've stayed up late, therefore we're going to lie in. This palpable gross play, the silly play of Pyramus and Thisbe put on by the mechanicals, has well beguiled the heavy gate of night. It's made the time pass. "Sweet friends to bed, a fortnight hold we this solemnity in nightly revels and new jollity." So this is a very happy celebratory ending. Theseus is saying we're all going to bed, but we're going to keep celebrating for the next fortnight. But he's also saying it's fairy time, the fairies might creep out now. And that's exactly what happens. Next we see Puck, who says to us, "Now the hungry lion roars, and the wolf behowls the moon, whilst the heavy ploughman snores, all with weary task foredone. Now the wasted brands do glow, whilst the screech owl, screeching loud, puts the wretch that lies in woe in remembrance of a shroud." So someone that's lying awake, unhappy with insomnia, the sound of the screech owl screaming makes him think of a shroud, makes him or her think of death. "Now is the time of night," he continues, "that the graves, all gaping wide, every one lets forth his sprite in the churchway paths to glide." So he's saying all the graves are opening and the sprites, the spirits or ghosts, are coming up out of them, just as Hamlet's father's ghost rises at night in Hamlet. And Puck continues, "And we fairies that do run by the triple Hecate's team from the presence of the sun, following darkness like a dream." So he's saying that the fairies follow Hecate or Hecate, known as the queen of the witches, in running away from the sun and pursuing the night. He continues, "Now our frolic, not a mouse," so the fairies are now frolicking, "not a mouse shall disturb this hallowed house. I am sent with broom before to sweep the dust behind the door." So he's saying that the palace is hallowed, is holy, and he's sent to clean it. That's a kind of benign, good fairy sort of thing to do. But before he says that, he's set up this terrifying nighttime world of insomnia and screech owls and graves opening and ghosts walking, which seems an incredibly dark and disturbing way to end a play that's essentially being tied up with marriage and a happily ever after. Oberon, king of the fairies, seems to have a similar idea when he says, "Through the house give gathering light, by the dead and drowsy fire, every elf and fairy sprite hop as light as bird from briar." So again, this is a positive image. These lovely elves and fairy sprites are hopping about the house as the fire is dead. But even just the use of the word dead to describe the fire reminds us of the darker resonances of Puck's speech while he's talking positively about the entry of all these fairies. Those of you who saw video one of this series about Macbeth may remember that I talked about a lawyer's pamphlet that said that the first and chief use of a house is to defend man from the extremity of wind and weather, and by the receipt of comfortable light and wholesome air into the same, to preserve man's body and health. So a house forms a shelter from the elements, just as I discussed last week in relation to King Lear, but it also lets light and healthy air in. The pamphlet continues, "If one who hath a horrible sickness be in my house and will not depart, an action will lie against him, so he'll go to court, because he infecteth the air." I'm not talking this week about magical infection. The fairies aren't associated, like the witches, with contagious and dangerous air. But there's still a sense, as with the witches in Macbeth, that the fairies' influence here is coming to pervade the house, that the outside world of the fairies is associated with dewdrops, with nature, with parks, with bushes, with briars. is now infecting the inside world that's supposed to keep outside elements out. There's a confusion of outside and in. And while in Macbeth, the witches never actually come inside the castle, even if their influence is felt there, Lady Macbeth may call upon spirits, but we never see them. In some ways, the ending of Midsummer Night's Dream is much more threatening and disconcerting because the fairies are there, we see them on the stage, and we hear that Oberon is calling on all his fairies so that the palace will be overrun. He continues, "Now until the break of day, through this house each fairy spray, to the best bride bed will be, which by us shall blessed be, and the issue there create ever shall be fortunate." So Oberon's essentially saying, fairies go throughout the house and bless the bride bed so that any children that are conceived on this wedding night or in this marriage will be fortunate. So again, benign, good fairies. He ends the speech with this field dew consecrate, every fairy take his gate and each several chamber bless through this palace with sweet peace and the owner of it blessed ever shall in safety rest. Trip away, make no stay, meet me all by break of day. So here we're getting the reassuring comic ending. He's saying that everyone's going to be consecrated, so sort of using a religious vocabulary, with field dew, with the dew that we heard about in the fairy's first speech. So everything is being left good and blessed and safe and preserved by Oberon and the fairies, who are now leaving before dawn. Their work in the night has been done. But again, in bringing the dew, the field dew, inside, there's that sense of the boundaries between outside and inside, between the palace and the woods, blurring, so that fairy influence has come to pervade the world of the humans. And I just want us to think for a moment about a domestic manual from this period that some of you may remember I mentioned in week 2, talking about Romeo and Juliet. It's by someone called Thomas Tusser, and it's called 500th points of good husbandry united to as many of good huswifery, and it's all in rhyme, so it tells housewives and husbands how they ought to behave in rhyme. And in the section on good huswifery, Tusser writes of how a woman should behave at night. He says, "The first cock crowing," so the cock is crowing in the middle of the night, so the housewife will wake and hear the cock-a-doodle-doo. He continues, "Now, dame, it is midnight. What rumbling is that?" So you hear the cock crowing, you listen, it's midnight, and you listen out for any sounds, any rumbling. He continues, "The next cock showeth," so the next time you hear the cock crowing, "take heed to false harlots, and more ye what, you know what." So saying, watch out for any harlots that might be creeping about your house at night. And he continues, "If noise you do hear, look all things be clear, lest drabs do annoy thee and thieves destroy thee." So I discussed in my videos on both Othello and Romeo and Juliet how the house is associated with keeping things safe in this period. And the two main things that should be kept safe are possessions and chastity. And Thomas Tusser is suggesting that anyone who's creeping about the house at night can be threatening either of those. They could be drabs or harlots, so promiscuous women creeping about the house, or they could be thieves coming to steal things. So it's important, he thinks, to listen out for nighttime noises and for any nighttime movement. So this gives us a sense of how an early modern audience, even while they accepted that the fairies are blessing the beds and the future offspring of these marriages and tying up the comedy, might have been aware of a slightly unsettled feeling that these creatures are creeping about the house at night without being overheard. And then the play ends with Puck's epilogue, where Puck turns to the audience and speaks to us and involves us in the end of the play. Puck says, famously, "If we shadows have offended, think but this, and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here while these visions did appear, and this weak and idle theme no more yielding than a dream." And then he ends his speech with, "Give me your hands if we be friends," so applaud if we're friends, "and Robin shall restore amends." Now this is a lovely epilogue that seems to say, if you didn't enjoy the play, just imagine that you dreamed it. but this is a particularly resonant thing to suggest, considering what the characters in the play believe. The lovers and Bottom believe that they've dreamed the magic that they've experienced in the woods, the enchantments they've undergone, and the dangers they've undergone. Bottom says, "I have had a dream, past the wit of man to say what dream it was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream." And you may remember I've talked about the popularity of ballads as a form of cheap print of another form of entertainment to the theatre in this period, in earlier videos. He says, "I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream. It shall be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom." So Bottom wrongly believes that the enchantment by Puck on Titania that caused her to think that Bottom was her love is nothing more than a dream he's imagined. And he's completely forgotten the fact that he really was loved by a fairy queen, and that she really did prevent him from leaving the forest, even if he wished to. So he's imagined that all of this that he's experienced in the course of the play was only a dream. And Puck is saying to us, to the audience, that we can do that too. And of course, what happens when Bottom and when the lovers think that they've only dreamt what's happened is they then go home and dream at home. The lovers dream in the palace, in a house. And the fairies have followed them there. The fairies have followed them back to the house and moved around it at night. So I think there's something, again, slightly uncanny about Puck's suggestion that we, the audience, also imagine that we've only dreamed this play, because that seems to be hinting that maybe the fairies could follow us home as well. That's all we've got time for today, but thank you so much for taking the time to listen, and thank you very much to those of you who've listened to all of the series. If you have enjoyed Stay at Home Shakespeare, please do consider clicking like either on this video or in any other videos that you've enjoyed, or subscribing to the BitLit YouTube channel to get some more exciting literature videos and videos about performance, culture, and history more generally. Please do also comment underneath my videos if you have any questions or thoughts or things you'd like me to discuss, or any ideas for future series. I'm currently considering doing an At Home with Austin video series, so please do let me know if you think that's a good idea. Thank you so much, everyone, for taking the time to watch these videos, to share them, and to comment on them. And I'd like to end by saying, give me your hands, if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.